accept challenges, reject norms, push boundaries. This is Barrow Neurosurgery Basecamp. Your front seat to the teaching rounds of Michael Lawton and Juan Uribe. Join Barrow residents and renowned guests as they seek to understand the most complex, difficult, intricate cases. This is Inside Access you'll find nowhere else. A journey you'll never forget. Come with us as we climb the trail from base camp to the very pinnacle of neurosurgical excellence.
Theme for today is capitalize. We're going to talk about an AVM that was in the basal ganglia. This is an impossible place to go. You've got eloquent tissue all around, you've got the internal capsule behind you, and it's a very difficult spot to reach. But in this young lady, she had a hemorrhage, and her hematoma created a way to get to this AVM that wouldn't otherwise have been there. So it gives us an advantage. It gives us a way to capitalize on this blood clot to get down. We can go transylvian, we can go through the insula, we can get through the hematoma, and we can finally reach the AVM. So this is the lesson, is to find a way to look at your situation, survey the enemy, look for that advantage that the enemy has given you, and then use it to go for the win. AVM resections are like wars. As you plan your battle, you've got to look for that advantage, you've got to exploit it, capitalize on the weakness of the pathology, and go for the win.
Is in her late 50s. She presented with aphasia and right-sided weakness in May of this year and was found to have this lesion.
A left basal ganglia AVM. Do we know the size?
I think it was less than three.
Less than three, so we have 1 point for that. It's an eloquent location, so we'll give 1 point for that.
Where would you put it anatomically?
I bet it's in the pallidus, but I'm not.
Yeah, it's a palatal AVM, really. And the hemorrhage is in the putamen, more laterally. There's your angiogram.
So it has deep venous drainage, so 1 point for that.
What is that? What do we see in there?
The thalamus striate into the internal cerebral vein.
Okay, good. Let's just look at that again. What do you make of this? What is that?
I'm not sure. It could be the anterior choroidal artery feeding in.
Why don't you run that back and forth a little bit? Here's your choroidal. I'm going to give you that.
Near where I'd expect the BVR to go.
So that's BVR. So your choroid is here, and that's what you're seeing in the arterial phase. Your plexal point is out here, but that's not all that runs in the ambient cistern. Your BVR also runs there, and this comes in late, and it's outlining uncus, and it's following the ambient cistern back, and you can see it join your glenic complex up here. See how it joins the right there?
Yeah.
Yep, so that's a small BVR, yep.
That's a three on the Spetzler Martin.
Is that your three?
Yep. For the modified, we'll see 50. So 50 is 3 points for that. It looks compact, so that's 0 points for that. Did it bled on the CT? So since it bled, that has 0 points. So for a final Lawton-Young, modified of six. So in theory, by the numbers, it's surgically resectable. Transylvian fissure, transinsular approach gets you through the insula, the claustrum, putamen, where the bleeding is, and then gets you to the lateral aspect of it. Then you take the path of least eloquence given the hemorrhage already. Obviously, the corticospinal tract is going to be at the very end of your resection.
Look how close that is on the back edge. So there's your posterior limb, your anterior limb is here. It's sitting like the palatum, right in that crotch between the two limbs.
That's the approach that would take advantage of the damage already caused by the lesion.
We did debate coming in this way through the ventricle, but you can see that it's covered by caudate and it never bled into the ventricle. So you would lose all the advantage of this beautiful hematoma, which is here. So that really is what makes this an operable case. If this was not a ruptured AVM, or if you didn't have that nice hematoma, it wouldn't be nearly as operable. This is another one that it all begins and ends with the Sylvian fissure split. And unless you can split that fissure, you'll never get this going. So luckily for us, the veins were actually pretty nice. You've got this nice big vein that kind of joins the fissure, but there's a lot of running room in between here and back in here. So the veins were a big help. And again, with these fissure splits, the whole secret is to find your arteries that come in and out. And you can find them in a couple of key places. And then you know that there's going to be an area around each of these arteries that's nice to open, because the fissure, the cistern, is fairly wide there. And then it's going to be very difficult in between, where the operculum goes pia to pia. So you always start there. You start at these areas where the arteries come, and you can see how it starts to take you in. And you just gotta keep following. And the key is to get through the operculum. So you just gotta keep deepening your dissection. And here, you have to remember what lives here.
So at the posterior part of the temporal operculum, you have the Haeschel's gyrus. Wernicke is gonna be posterior to that, on the left side, and the primary auditory complex is deep in those Haeschel gyruses, posterior to the plantar temporal.
Yeah, so you've got Haeschel in here, you've got Wernicke there, and you've got Broca probably somewhere in here. So you've got to be really careful of this tissue, because we're on the left side. And so it's got to be, good peel preservation, not getting subpeel, and keeping that as best you can. So here now you can see, what are we looking at there?
So this is one of the M2s, probably the inferior trunk. The most important trunk probably is the one you have the sucker on. It's probably the M2 at the central sulcus of the insula, which develops into the artery, the central artery at the convexity.
This is insula here, and you can see there are short gyri that kind of radiate here, and then your long gyri are going to be further back out of view here. So we've exposed the anterior insula, but you see how this is Lehman insula here, and we've had to split all this to bring those short gyri into view. So you really need to open that up to get there.
You can also look on the cortical surface for the central sulcus.
It's in parallel with the central sulcus. So for me, what I do is I look for pars triangularis. That's probably the most recognizable landmark. The one behind it is your motor cortex, and so your central sulcus is here, and that tells you that that's basically this. That's going to be the dividing line, the central sulcus of the insula. So you don't have to look at all this stuff. You don't have to dissect any further. If you can spot your anatomy of Broca's area, it'll lead you to that dividing line between the short and the long gyri. Now what are you going to do?
Do my entry point anterior to that central sulcus.
You're going to go one, two, or three, or four.
Three and four are out of the picture. Four will get you to the ventricle. Three will get you too close to the limiar insulae. And one probably will get you aligned to Monroe. So I would either do one or two. Preferably, I would do one over two for trajectory purposes.
If you go one, the problem is you're going to have to work between these arteries, these two trunks, and that's going to box you in. So I wanted to be all the way above because this thing rose all the way up to nearly the ventricle. So I wanted a view looking up into that circular sulcus. So I wanted to go either two or three. And as it turns out, because there's a little branch, there's a trunk that goes up like this, I use both two and three. This is that trunk. There's one limb here and the other limb goes up like this. So I'm going right in between those. The nice thing about the hematoma is that it creates a little hemosiderin gradient. So the deeper we go, the more yellow this gets.
Did you split forward to see the M1 and that major lenticular stripe before?
Major trunk. This is the inferior trunk. I followed it down and I could see the lenticular striates kind of diving in somewhere in here. So I knew I needed to get, further forward into that third space that you didn't want to go into, but this is that number three. Number two is back here. This is number three. And I'm gonna basically connect two and three because one of these little openings wasn't enough. But you can see how we're basically straddling that little branch, and I've connected the two like two fingers of the bowling ball, and it joins to that hematoma, which is underneath here. This was actually a really well-behaved AVM. And you can see this is all hemosiderin. It covered the nidus, so it was hard to actually appreciate where the nidus was. But just by gently getting through that, you could start to see these little vessels. And the whole idea was that we wanted to find the lenticular striates early. This AVM was very linear. The lenticular striates were coming in this way. You had nidus here, and you had a vein coming out the top. So the idea was to come in low, interrupt these early so that this thing slowed itself down, then dissect around the nidus here, get around this, and then I hadn't seen the vein, but I knew it was hiding at the top, so it wasn't until the very end that we spotted this here. But here you can start to see these vessels coming into view, going through the parenchyma, and here, if you pick up the lenticular striates right at the inferior margin of the nidus, you know that they're going to be feeding arteries and not normal lenticular striates. So here you're starting to see kind of the nidus start to liberate itself. We're all the while working between those little openings around this branch here. And you can see how the hunt is really for those feeders. You can see one of them right there. This guy right there. There's another one right there. And then here towards the end, I think you can see right there, that's the vein coming into view. And you can see that at this stage of the game, it's dark. So that means after taking those lenticular striate feeders, we've got this thing cornered. Yeah, here's the vein. There you can see the vein finally leaving the top of this thing. Here it goes up and works its way to the ventricle, but I didn't want to follow it all the way to the ventricle because the further I follow it along that course, the closer I get to the internal capsule. So to stay low and away from that, I know that this vein is dark. There's nothing else feeding it because of its color. And that tells me that it's probably safe just to take it at this low point and stay away from the eloquence. And our nidus is here. So we're gonna come across the vein here and finish this off. So you can see in the end, this is that resection corridor. It straddles this trunk, but we've got something here and something there. We've got our eloquence nicely saved here. We've got everything on this side is preserved over there, and our trunks are running in through here. So it's an obstacle course, but that's how you do it. It's the only way to get there. When you look down the fissure, here's your temporal lobe here. That's superior temporal gyrus. On this side, you're gonna have an orbital gyrus here. You're gonna look for pars triangularis, which is gonna be somewhere probably right in here. So orbitalis, triangularis, and then opercularis will be back here. And then that subcentral gyrus is gonna be running in through here. So if you continue the line of the central sulcus across the fissure and down into the insula, they line up. So the central sulcus of the insula is the same as the central sulcus of the hemisphere. So that tells you if you line it up on your pre-op films that you've got to be back in the long gyra, you've got to go past that point. back in here. If you don't need to go that far, you can stay anterior.
You see normal lenticular striates kind of in their different orientation at the depths?
Yeah, we did see those. This is the carotid here. The M1 is running here, and you can see a lot of activity in here, but you can't tell what's normal and what's not normal. So if you were to go down there and just start taking things, you'll take the good with the bad. So you can't do that. All I did was to get a read on these, and it gave me the sense that these were going in this direction here, and I lined that up with my opening, and you can just sort of triangulate to see how they're going to come in, because they followed a straight line in. If you think about how that AVM is oriented, you've got nidus here, and you've got the feeders coming in, and then you've got your draining vein coming out. You're going to then come in with your surgical approach this way. So you're going to get to that nidus, and all of that feeding stuff is going to be on the opposite side, and it's going to be hard for you to get there. So if you get bleeding at this point, you're in trouble, because you'll have to work your way around and underneath to control those feeders. If you do it this way, you can see how you get to that stuff early. It's just like an aneurysm mentality. You take away the proximal control, the proximal feeders, and this thing, by the time you actually are working your way around the nidus, it's already purple. So it's a much safer way to go. And plus, with that split, you can see, just looking at this, how you can get in there just fine if you do your dissection safely.